came to win, to fight, to conquer, to thrive. I came to win, to survive, to prosper, to rise. Studio Luxe is a makeup, started as a makeup studio, developed into a hair studio, nail studio. Honestly, it all kind of started just by me wanting to do makeup, and then things just kind of fell into place with Amber and Carrie. Honestly, it was, a lot of people think that starting a business is really hard, but I'm a firm believer of what is meant to be will be, and it just was so easy. You know, I'm a firm believer in things that come so easy, then just run with it. Something that's meant to happen will happen, so that's what I honestly think Studio Luxe is. It's just, I never thought that it would end up what it is. I think that women empowerment is really important, especially nowadays. And I just like that when people come here, they feel good. They could be coming here having a bad day, stressed out. You never know what their situation is, and we always make people feel better. So no matter if they're getting their hair done, their nails done, their makeup done, whatever, and that's just what I love about it. Studio Luxe has been open since September of 2014. I've been doing makeup for about 6 years now, and permanent makeup for about 2.5 years.
I am a hairstylist. I was born to do hair. Like I wake up every morning and I'm checking out hairstylists and what they're doing, what they have going on, you know, new trends, and how can I change a new trend. I'm not trying to be a follower, I'm trying to be a trendsetter. And so when you do a woman's hair, it makes her feel better from the inside out. And then you add that touch of makeup and that dash of nail polish, and it just all flows and comes together.
I think domestic violence is overlooked in so many different ways. The main reason I think it's so overlooked is because women are so strong and they try to hide it. And I think that by the women that we have in our showcase today, it shows a lot of self-respect that they have for themselves, their families, their kids, their daughters, because people need to know. And I think that it takes an amazing person to want to tell the world, you know, their struggle, because there's so many people that are scared. So I think that any chance that anyone gets to spread their word, or to, you know, even if it takes you a year or 2 years or 3 years, whenever you feel the need that you want to share your story, I think that that's very important, because there's always somebody who's still scared and they need to hear it. So,
because all it takes is for one shared story to save one scared life. It's so many women who think it's okay because they want to hide the bruises, the cuts. They want to hide being verbally abused, and, you know, being called a bitch is not all right. You know, being told to shut up is not all right. You know, it's okay to be a strong woman, but don't try to be so strong to where you, it's okay, he won't hit me again next time, or it was an accident, none of it's okay. And so many women need to understand that it's okay to want to, you know, tell your story to other women, because you really might save somebody's life.
My name's Tori. I was in an abusive relationship since 2012. I met my abuser 4 years into a relationship with my daughter's dad, and the relationship was rocky. We grew into different people, and I came across my son's dad. He was real flashy. I liked that, so that excited me, and I was just really drawn to him. And I left my daughter's dad. I got with him when my daughter was about 3 months old. So he did a good part in raising her. I felt like that was a really reason that I stayed into my relationship for so long. I failed my daughter of the family that I gave her, or wanted to give her. Mm-hmm. So I thought that I would give it my all and continue to persevere and try to work out the relationship with my son's dad for the family that my kids deserved. But it didn't work out. It was abusive. He was an alcoholic. And everything always got taken to the next level. I found myself fall victim. It was verbal, it was physical. He made me feel like less of a woman. He cheated on me, and so therefore he threw other women in my face. He made me feel that they were superior to me. They had more money, they had flashier clothes, nicer cars. And so here I was, insecure. I didn't believe in myself. I wasn't able to embrace who I really was. I was trying to make him be perfect for him and try to be the person to work on our relationship. But in the meantime, I kind of lost myself. So I had to isolate myself from everybody, which he kind of put me in a position to isolate myself from my friends and my family. That way I didn't have somebody to run to, you know, in the event that I needed to get out. So that pretty much forced me to rely on him, to depend on him. And so I finally came to the conclusion, a good friend of mine is a social worker, and she really stressed it to me that putting your kids through things like that is a form of abuse on your kids. And I thought, you know, I wanted to keep my family together for my kids, but it was so hard. And I thought, you know, here I am, and I'm so selfish that, you know, I want this family for my kids so bad that I was abusing them. And I was, you know, they were forced to watch their mom, whether it was verbally or physically. You know, they seen the hurt in me, and I feel like I wasn't able to be the best mom that I could be for them. I wasn't happy. I couldn't be happy for them. And so I finally started setting myself aside from him. And rather it be us as a team, I started making myself more independent. I started bossing up. I got a better job. I got my own house. And eventually I started really embracing myself and who I was. And I started finding myself. I found that I was just better individually. And so once I started to see the difference in my kids and the love and laughter in my house and how happy it was, I finally just came to the conclusion that it was time to end my relationship. And I stopped worrying so much about these other women and them winning and having him and the thought that they had him and I didn't. So I really started winning without him. And I let go of the fact that other women were going to be with him, that he was going to, you know, run off and have a life with somebody else. And ever since, I really, you know, I'm not his victim anymore. They are. And that's unfortunate. I don't want anybody to be in that predicament, but I've allowed myself to be happy. I've allowed myself to move on. And I've really gained my strength when I was able to leave him and become the independent person I am. And I really found myself. And I've been absolutely fabulous ever since.
My name is Tori, and I beat that.
Basically, we got together in high school, uh-huh. And everything was great. You know, he's my high school sweetheart. Everything was cool, you know. You know, we both was about that street life. So everything was fine up until I got pregnant, had my daughter. I think the first abusive thing happened the night I went into labor with my child. Mm-hmm. And then it just slowly progressed, you know, but it kind of overshadowed. I stayed because, you know, I thought that was the person I was supposed to be with forever. You know, he was the father of my child. I didn't want to have my child around a whole bunch of different people. So, you know, he put his hands on me, but then gave me $1,000, or, you know, so I was young, dumb, in love. I had my father was around, but he really wasn't a father figure, so maybe I looked at him as that comfort zone, or whatever, you know, so I thought, like, he came from a messed up background, too, so, you know, I kind of took it like he needed help, you know, I needed to be there basically for him, to be there to support him, to cover him, because he didn't have no mother, he didn't have a family, so So, you know, I didn't want to leave him because he wouldn't have nobody. So it was kind of like a guilt trip on both ends. But, you know, once I had my child, I realized that she was the most important thing, and I had to get out. The last straw was he coming in the house drunk. I'm laying in the bed with my daughter asleep. He tried to strangle me with a stitcher cord.
Whoa.
With my daughter in my hands, you know. Then I think he hit me with an Xbox, split my ear open. I ended up going to the hospital. Ever since that night, I ain't seen him ever since. You know, first time put the hands on you, leave. I mean, it's not gonna get no better. It all starts off slow. It progresses to worse, you know. Especially if that person's not trying to get no help. I mean, sometimes you can get help and you can change. You know, we all have our moments where we snap out, you know. Just like a man can put their hands on a woman can put their hands on a man. It all depends on if that person wants to change. I'm not saying that person can't change because they can. You know, anybody can change. But it's how long you want to put up with it, you know. My name is Tanea, and I need that.
And I was in an abusive relationship on and off for 7.5 years. Everything was awesome. We went to college together. We hung out with the same group of friends. My daughter was 8 months old when I first got with him. So, you know, he kind of helped me raise my first daughter. And after about 2.5 years, I found out that I was pregnant with my second daughter. And after that, everything went downhill.
Okay, when you say went downhill, like how did they go downhill?
When I got pregnant, I found out that he had been cheating on me, so I spent my pregnancy alone. After she was born, we decided to try to make it work again, and he asked me to move to Davenport from Clinton. So I did, so he got me away from my comfort zone, and after I moved here, it seemed like every other week, there was a fight, started with pushing me, then choking me, smacking me, then busted lips, black eyes, broken ribs. I have found the most amazing man ever. I'm engaged. My girls call him Daddy. I still, to this day, this happened about 3 years ago, I still have a restraining order against him. He has, in the past couple of months, started to see our daughter with supervised visits. But other than that, life is great. It is so hard to give advice because it seems like in abusive relationships, you're not done until you've had enough. Everybody tried to get me out of our relationship. My friends were worried about me. Anytime I wouldn't answer my phone for an hour, there was a whole call tree. Everybody called each other, asked if they had talked to me. I think that my advice would be more so for friends of people who are abused, just to always be there and always be that shoulder and be very supportive, because it's very hard. It sounds really crazy. It seems so easy to tell somebody, you know, they're cheating on you, they hit you, leave. It's not that easy to leave. My name's Kiara, and I beat that.
I knew that if I didn't get away from him, he was gonna kill me. So I called my brother and told him that I couldn't do it anymore, and he came and got me. Because he was always threatening to. He had beat me with baseball bats. It progressively got worse. First it was just his fists, and then he started using weapons, and he had bashed my face in and all kinds of stuff. And I knew that it was only gonna get worse from there if I didn't leave. He had made all my friends leave me. He wouldn't let me talk to any of them. He wouldn't let me talk to my family. The only way I got in contact with my brother was because I was at work, and I called my brother from the work phone and told him to come up there. But he wouldn't let me talk to any of my family members or any of my friends, so they kind of knew what was going on, but they didn't really know how bad it was. He could be a good guy, you know, if he got help, and he really needs to seek God, too. You might feel like you're alone. You might feel like you don't really have anybody and you don't know which way to turn or how to get yourself out of it. But there's always somebody that cares about you. Even if it's not your family or your friends, there's going to be somebody out there that really cares about you. And God cares about you. You know, you're His child and He wants the best for you. You just take that step to try to reach out to somebody, anybody, and get out of what you're doing. You can do it and you are strong. My name is Katie and I beat that.
Hi, my name is Deja. I was in an abusive relationship on and off for 5-6 years, give and take. Kind of still am, but that's neither here nor there. My first encounter with domestic violence wasn't actually my own experience. I had a best friend. I have a best friend. I'm like to talk about her in past tense form. She died in 2008, June 15th, 2008. She was a victim of domestic violence. Her boyfriend killed her. And I always said I would never be in a situation like that, but I guess you can never say what you won't be in until you're actually in that situation. Because a few years later, 2010-ish, I found myself dealing with a guy, and he was just like the guy that killed my friend. But luckily for me, I survived that situation. I made it. I'm a survivor. It wasn't easy. We went through a lot. Everything was perfect when I first met him. It was like too perfect. It was like a fairy tale. Like, it was everything I imagined. He took care of home. He did everything for me. I had a child previous to my relationship who he took care of. He didn't treat her no different from his own children. Everything was like love. And then I'll never forget the first time he beat me up. I felt like it was my fault. I made excuses for it. I kind of distanced myself from my family and my friends. And then after that, it just didn't stop. It just kind of got worse. I was content with everything he was doing for me. Like, he did everything. He paid bills. He took care of me. He took care of my kid. He took care of his other kids. I, like, felt like I needed him at the time. So, no, like, I don't know. Our relationship was so perfect besides he, like, but I felt like he, like, never had anybody to love him because he had a troubled childhood. So I felt like maybe, like, that was part of, I always said, like, maybe he didn't have nobody to love him, so he didn't know how to love nobody. That's the person he wanted to be. He just didn't know how to express himself as a person. And then when he felt, like, too comfortable in situations, he needed to have control in situations. He didn't like being 50-50. He always wanted to have the upper hand in situations. And when he felt like he couldn't control situations, he would abuse me and all that. We were at my house. It was him and his friend. Me and my daughter were already at the house. He came to the house. We got into it about a text message or a phone call or something, and he beat me up in front of my daughter. That was the first time that happened. And I went crazy. Like, we was, like, really going crazy. Like, I was bleeding. It was just, like, tragic. And I said, like, I never wanted my daughter to experience that, but once it happened, it just kept happening.
I never wanted my child to see that. It's just so hard because as far as a person, like, he's not shit, but he's a good father. Like, my daughter never had a dad, and he stepped up, and he was the father figure for her. But he's, like, not shit as a person, but I never wanted my daughter to see that. I never want her to think that's okay. And for 5 years, she saw him abuse me. It was just fucking, I couldn't even tell you. I just was scared to leave. And like I said, we were together for 5 years. It was always on and off. Like, he would cheat on me. Like, we'd break up. I would leave him. But I found myself back with him because I was content with him doing everything. Like, he took care of home. Like, everything he did, he, like, took care of home. And I was content with that. And fuck it. Then I depended on him a lot. That's what it was. I needed him. Time just had passed. I got over it. I began to find myself and become independent. We had moved. I was working. I had had my son. My son was getting older. We had moved out of town. I didn't have any family. I just had him and my kids. And I just was, like, over that situation. And I just left. And I just was, like, content. Like, I'd rather struggle than be in that situation. And when I left him for the last time, he was like, oh, you'll be back, this and that.
And I was like, thinking in my head, like, you know, I might. But at the point, I was just so fed up. I was leaving. And I had my shit packed for like a week. And then I finally left. Or I'll never forget the day I left. It was like right before my son's birthday. My son was turning 2. It was like maybe a couple days before his birthday. And I left. And he was like, well, I'm keeping the kids. And I was like, that's fine. And I left him. And I left my kids. And it was the hardest thing to do. And I just never looked back. And life has just been so great since then. See, find help. Don't ever blame yourself. Don't ever belittle yourself. Don't ever fault yourself for that shit. Like, just get out of that situation. And as fast as you got into it, you can get out of it. And you can find somebody that will love you. And fucking, if you need to love yourself before you worry about somebody loving you. Because that was my problem. Like, I felt I was looking for love in all the wrong places, and that's how I ended up in my situation.
Okay.
My name's Deja, and I beat that 2 times.
My name's Valerie, and I was involved with this. My oldest daughter's father, he wasn't the physical violence that I had to deal with. People talk about the domestic violence and the physical part, but a lot of people forget that the mental part is just as devastating. You have your bruises on the inside, nobody can see them, but it's bruised to your self-esteem, and someone can really tear you down mentally and financially. And that's what I dealt with. I had my daughter. I was always told that, you know, I was never told I was pretty. I was never told I was beautiful. I was always told that I needed to get my head together. Something's wrong with me mentally. Things like that. I sometimes worked 2 full-time jobs to support the household while he was being the temperamental chef going from job to job and never really contributing to the household. As time went on, I wanted to go back to school. I went back to school. I was working full time. I was on the dean's list, taking care of my child as best I could, and he would still find something to complain about. Didn't matter what I did, how much I did it, and I started finding myself that I was losing myself. I was losing who I was, what I wanted, what I'd like to do. I had no self-esteem. I didn't even know who I was. I didn't even know what I liked. I had no idea where my life was heading. Fortunately, I have a very good family that helped me figure that out, gave me the opportunity to move in with them, get my life together, and I'm very thankful for that. My thoughts to other women who are going through that mental abuse, because that's a hard one. You don't really realize you're going through it until you get out of it. But my advice to them is listen carefully. If a man is telling you that there's something wrong with you all the time, if a man is telling you you're never good enough, you're never pretty enough, then there's something wrong with him. And he has a low self-esteem. Misery loves company. And you can be bad and do bad by yourself, but you don't need somebody to always tear you down. The world, there's enough in the world to tear us down. But no one needs to have somebody close to them that they're supposedly in a relationship with, tearing them down. A relationship is supposed to boost each other up, not tear you down. So my advice to young ladies anywhere who is watching this, if you're going through this, then you need to make a way to get out and stay out. It's not worth it trying to go back, because they'll just throw that in your face and make it worse for you. So once you decide to leave. Don't look back. Don't come back. It's not worth it. My name's Valerie, and I beat that.
situation that we had was the worst situation. Pretty much he just kind of came over, busted in, wasn't supposed to be there, already had a restraining order. My daughter was upstairs and she came downstairs to pretty much him just beating my things, me screaming. I don't even remember anything after the first hit. That's what she came down to. She called 911. But I mean, even to this day, she's still scared at home. Nothing is going to change my mind. But to just be aware, you know, open your eyes, because it may start small, it always does, but it gets progressively worse. And if you don't pull yourself out of that situation, you might not be so lucky. And you could end up dead. My mom was a very, very beautiful woman, and she had a lot of confidence, and I think that kind of would always put men in a position where they felt like they had to do whatever they could to keep her, because she was really independent and she didn't really stand for too much BS. My mom was the crazy thing about it, that my mom was murdered October 1st of 2004, and she was born August 1st, 1964. So she was exactly 40 years old when she passed away. 40 years old and what is that, 3 months from August to October? Exactly 40 years old. I was 15. I think the most important thing that I learned is that love is not controlling. Love will let you be free, and not to be silent about your situation. If you're going through something, no matter what it is, whether it's domestic violence, you know, verbal violence, to speak out about it, because there's more people who are going through what you're going through than what you probably know. She was dating someone for about a year, and she moved him in and out. There was constant physical as well as verbal abuse between the two of them. He was already in a relationship at the time that him and my mom got together, and he kind of left that relationship to be in a relationship with my mom. Ended up being that my mom didn't want to continue to pursue a relationship with him because he would make comments to her about being a sharpshooter in the one branch of the military, I don't know. And I think she, for the first time ever, really was spooked behind it. So she came to me one night and she gave me a sock full of money, and I didn't really understand why. But later on, I heard some tussling and some wrestling around in the house, and I heard some keys jingling, and then I heard footsteps go down the stairs, two sets of footsteps, and then I heard pops. And I came out of my room and I went downstairs and I found her at the bottom of the stairs. I think this might sound crazy, but I really do think that he was crazy in love with my mom. I think that he found someone that he felt he was so compatible with. He couldn't lose her, and besides that, he had jeopardized so many things within his own life. Like I said, he was already in a relationship, so he had jeopardized that relationship with the woman that he was with, semi-relationship with some of his children because they had animosity towards him for leaving, and made a lot of sacrifices for my mom. You know, he
I think he even lost his job at one point in time because he was so wrapped up in the relationship that he focused so much on it. To be honest with you, I don't think that I was thinking. I think that I was so numb and so like, because I knew as soon as I heard the gunshots that they were gunshots. And it's not like I really grew up in an area where that was prevalent. You know what I'm saying? So for me to know right away automatically what it was and have grown up in an environment where fighting was common, I kind of already knew. So I was just numb and in disbelief. My mom had already had the phone in her hand, and the way she was laying was, I don't want to be too descriptive because I don't want to make this too emotional, but the way she was laying, she had already had the phone in her hand, and it was above her head. So, and 911 was already dialed on the phone. So all I had to do was grab the phone and dial 911, and then I went next door to the neighbor's house because I had a friend that lived there. He got ghosted. He disappeared. They found him in Memphis, Tennessee, I want to say a week or two later. It wasn't that long afterwards, but I know that he had been calling my mom's phone and leaving voice messages on her phone, and a lot of it was like you couldn't really understand what he was saying. There was a lot of static and mumbling, but I think he had realized what he had done, but also didn't really believe that she was gone.
Okay, what did your brother do when that happened? Like, did he react to it? He lost his mind.
He lost his mind. I mean, he changed. My brother was a mama's boy, and he changed so much. He got into a lot of trouble with the law, and he just became secluded into himself. And even to this day, he doesn't communicate with people. He feels like he's all that he has.
Okay. What is your brother doing now?
He's a tattoo artist. He lives in Oregon. He's a tattoo artist and a very, very good one at that. So he has channeled his energy into something that, you know, is positive for himself and for other people.
And whatever happened to that guy? Did he like get sentenced to like jail time? He got life?
No.
He didn't?
No. No, they sentenced him to 60 years, between 60 and 68 years, something like that. I was a part of the trial for it, but I didn't get to sit in on any of it because when you're an eyewitness, you really can't. So, but they did sentence him to a long time, and he won't ever get out. I mean, obviously, because when he went in, he was in his late 40s. So the most important piece of advice that I would say is to be safe, because I know we say get out of the situation, but sometimes I understand where women come from when they say that it's difficult, because it really is. And so my most important piece of advice would to be safe trying to get out and use your resources. You don't have to be obvious about it, but there's so many places that are willing to help you and talk to people, because I think that people who are victims of domestic violence think that if they talk to someone, they're going to be judged, or that people won't understand. But if you talk to enough people about it, eventually there's going to be someone who does care enough to give you good advice or to help you. Not everyone will turn away from you or judge your situation.
Okay, see, my last question for you is, seeing this, what this guy did to your mother, mm-hmm. did this change your outlook on men?
In a way, it did. In a way, it changed my outlook on men. It made me feel like, you know, if a man could hurt someone, whether it be a man or a woman, you know what I'm saying? If a man could hurt someone,
you don't really know how to have that trust. And I think maybe a mixture of that with my dad not really being there for me and knowing how he hurt my mother too, it kind of made me feel like I don't have an example of what a good man is. And so, of course, in turn, that's going to make you feel like you don't know what to look for. You know what I'm saying? You don't know what a good man is. Because you, the people that were supposed to love you or are supposed to care about you or care for the woman that was most important in your life didn't do that. So how do you know what it looks like? How do you identify it?
Somehow I've got to be brave and unveil that silence. One step, two steps, three steps, then four, the fifth step, sixth step, how many more? It seems like an eternity, no matter how short the journey is, when you're traveling to a destiny that is not supposed to be yours. I found her, lying there at the bottom of the stairs. Knees buckled, throat gurgling, gasping for air. There's blood in her hair, and I'm so numb that all I can do is just stare. Mom. Mom. Wait, where? Where's the phone? Mom. On October 1st of 2004, at 12 a.m., my mother became the murder victim of a domestically violent relationship. She had only been engaged in that in particular relationship for a very unsteady year. She was a mother, a daughter, a sister, an aunt, a friend, and she was taken too soon. This is the first time that I've ever publicly spoken out and the first time that I've broken my silence. For me, for the voice that she no longer has, and for all women everywhere who deal with domestic abuse. I'm honored to be here and today's showcase alongside all of these beautiful ladies who are also survivors of domestic abuse. We beat that, ladies.
We can win, to fight, to conquer, to thrive. I came to win, to survive, to prosper. To fly. Yo, yo. I wish today it would rain on
all day. Maybe that'll kind of make the pain go away. Trying to forgive you for abandoning me. Praying, but I think I'm still an angel away. Angel away, yeah, strange in a way. Maybe that is why I chase strangers away. They got their out aiming at me. But I become Neo when they aiming at me. Me against them, me against enemies, me against friends. Somehow they both seem to become one. A sea full of sharks and they all smell blood. They start coming and I start rising. Must be surprising, I'm just surmising. I win, thrive, soar, higher, 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 more fire.
To win, to fly, to conquer, to thrive. I came to win, to survive, to prosper, to rise.
Every time it locks me in, painting their own pictures and they crop me in. But I will remain where the top begins. Cause I am not a word, I am not a line. I am not a girl that can ever be defined. I am not fly, I am levitation. I represent an entire generation. I hear the criticism loud and clear. That is how I know that the time is near.
We beat that. Studio Luxe. Jennifer Davis, Amber Bruce, Shante Pierce, Carrie Bishop, Daniel Shepard, Megan Norskull, Kayla Rager, Silk, Bruce, Kevin Phelps on the photography, all the models, Nation Dunbar, Katie Langan, Regina Garnett, Valerie Beerman, Natasha Taylor, Tanea Harris, and Camara Morrison. Give it up for Jennifer Davis, Amber Bruce, straight out of Studio Luxe, y'all.
Get ready for it, I came.